much. It's a pleasure to be here. We face many challenges in the world today. We have a population that's expected to reach nearly 10 billion by 2050. Agriculture productivity needs to increase by 50% to reach that, to be able to feed that population. On top of that, climate change is going to be continuing, and that will decrease crop productivity by 40% by 2050 and by 80% by the turn of the century. And of course, that will increase due to our energy needs going up. And that will add more pollution to the atmosphere and decrease crop productivity. And on top of that, the medications that we use, the organisms that they treat, have grown resistant to them. So we need new medications, and we're not finding those fast enough. So I'm going to talk to you about addressing some of these.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to talk about addressing some of these needs and work that we've done in my laboratory to address them. So I want to talk about how biology can solve these challenges. And then in the end, I'm going to talk about how we can improve biology as a manufacturing platform to address all of these challenges. So let's first talk about health. And I want to start with a story. This is George. I met George when I was in Kenya a few years ago. George lives on Lake Kisumu, there in the circle. And 80% of the people in this area have malaria. When I met George that day, he came in, it was a very warm day, but George was wrapped in clothes. It was clear that he was very ill and he had a runny nose. The clinic that he was at is shown here at the bottom, and there were children lined up waiting to get in. And at the top there is the typical mud hut that George lives in. So George came in, the nurse suspected he had malaria. She pricked his finger, put a drop of blood on the test kit, then followed it up with a few drops of buffer. And in just a few seconds, she had the diagnosis. And it was by those two lines. The top line, the control line, said that the test kit worked. And the bottom line, the test line, told us that George had malaria. She then weighed George and pulled out a pack of pills, gave him the first one, and turned to his brother and said he needs to take each pill every 12 hours until he finishes them all. She repeated the instructions and sent them on their way. And then she said to me, she said, Jay, by the time he gets to the third pill, he's going to feel great. And his mother will realize that the next time George gets malaria, which will probably be in just a few months, she won't have access to those pills. And so she'll tuck them away and wait for him to get it again. And this is one of the challenges in treating malaria. If you don't use all of the pills, then the malaria is going to grow resistant to it, and they won't be effective the next time. This is a map of malaria on the planet. Roughly a third to a quarter of the population is at risk of getting malaria. At any one time, about 250 million people have malaria, and every year about a million people die of malaria. This drug is a Chinese therapy, herbal therapy, that goes way back in history. It's called artemisinin, and it comes from this plant Artemisia annua, or wormwood. It was discovered back about 150 BC, where it was first used for treating hemorrhoids and then later used for treating malaria, completely forgotten until a woman named Yu Tu, shown here, discovered it and purified the active ingredient. And by 2004, the World Health Organization is recommending this as the drug of choice for treating malaria. Yu Tu won the Nobel Prize last year for her work on discovering artemisinin. Here's how we get artemisinin. It's grown on plantations, we purify it, and then we do some chemical conversion of it to get to the active ingredients that are formulated into the tablets like what George took. Now the challenge with artemisinin is that the cost and the amount, the supply, are often uncoupled, and it makes it a challenge for people like George to get access to the drug. So shown here is the artemisinin price. When it was recommended as the drug of choice in 2004, the price went way up to about $1,000 a kilogram. Farmers started planting in Southeast Asia, not so far from here. They had an oversupply 2 years later, and the price plummeted. And so you see these swings in price and availability, and it makes it very difficult for pharmaceutical companies to source enough of the drug so that people like George will have access to it. When the price is very high, people like George can't afford the drug. So my lab had the mission to engineer microbes to produce this drug, and in doing so, we would increase the supply, reduce the price, and make it available for everyone at a very low price. So in short, what we did is we went into Artemisia annua, we found the metabolic pathway, the enzymes that are responsible for making the drug. We then looked for the genes, cloned those genes out, and placed them into yeast. And the yeast then produces this drug. And it'll do so in a very simple way. It's just like brewing beer, except rather than producing beer, the yeast produces the artemisinin. And in fact, it produces so much artemisinin that it crystallizes out when the cells grow in culture. So these specks that you see on the glass here are actually crystallized artemisinin that the cells have produced, and it purifies itself. This is the facility that Sanofi built in Italy to do the last conversion. So yeast produces artemisinic acid, then we use a light catalyzed reaction to transform it into artemisinin, and this is the full-scale production facility that's used to produce the artemisinin. And there it is in another picture. As of a few months ago, 15 million treatments had been shipped to Africa and Southeast Asia that were produced using this engineered yeast that we developed in my laboratory. And every year, Sanofi and its partners will have the capacity to produce between 100 to 150 million treatments, which is half the world's needs. I want to talk about, in a similar way, how we can use biology to solve another problem, and that is the challenge around renewable energy and global warming. So I think most of you know that we get all of our fuel and nearly all of the other products that we use from petroleum that we pump up from underground, and we flow through a refinery, and we make all of these other products. And when you burn those fuels in your car, you add carbon dioxide to the atmosphere that wasn't there. We'd like to have a more renewable future, a future that's based on renewable products. One possibility is that we could collect sunlight and carbon dioxide from the atmosphere using plants in the form of sugarcane, corn, or even cellulosic biomass. We would then transform that into fuels and all these other products through a biorefinery. And when you burn those fuels in your car, you would be returning carbon dioxide to the atmosphere that the plants have collected. And this way, you would have a completely renewable and carbon neutral process. Now, one of the challenges is that the fuels that are most widely used and produced using biology are ethanol. Unfortunately, these won't work in trucks and in airplanes. So we really need hydrocarbon fuels, not alcohol-based fuels. So my laboratory has been working on engineering microbes to produce hydrocarbon fuels. In a similar vein to what we did with the artemisinin work, we take genes from plants and other organisms that produce hydrocarbons in plants, and we transform those genes into microbes, into E. coli, the bacterium, or into yeast. And when we do that, they then will produce the fuel. And if you've engineered the microbe appropriately, it'll produce exactly the right fuel so that you can drive your car or your truck or your plane. This is a picture of where the microbes, in this case, E. coli, have produced the fuel. So these little specks here are E. coli, and these blebs are diesel fuel that they've produced and excreted. And you can see that it floats top there, and that makes a very easy purification method. You grow the cells up in a tank, you feed them sugar, they transform the sugar into the fuel, it floats to the top, and you can then take it, skim it off, and drive away in your automobile. I want to talk just a little bit about the environment and other things we can do with biology. And that is producing all these other products. I mentioned to you that we get most of the products we use from petroleum. The carpet on the floor, the materials on the chair, the paint on the walls, the paint on the ceiling, all of this comes from petroleum. And we'd like to get these from a more renewable source, and in this way we would clean up the environment because many of the processes that are used to produce these products are polluting. So if you just look at the products that are made from petroleum, it's huge. And I actually culled the list down substantially. The list was much longer when I got it off the internet. Now, about 15 to 20% of every barrel of oil goes into producing all these other products. The other 80 to 85% goes into producing fuel. So how can we get all of these other products? Well, we wanted to engineer microbes to do this. And we've come up with a method in our laboratory to be able to engineer microbes to produce some of these products. The chemicals that are in these products are very different from the chemicals that are in fuels, but with the right technology, you can engineer microbes to produce them. And the technology we use is we look for microbes in the soil, microbes that would naturally produce various chemicals to fight each other in the soil. We take the genes out of those microbes, we put them together in an organism like E. coli or yeast, and when we do that, we can get E. coli and yeast to produce things like carpet fiber. So in the future, we'll be able to have renewable carpet fiber produced from sugar using microbes. Now, I want to talk just a bit about biomanufacturing and where it's going. It's a platform for manufacturing for the future, using microbes and plants to produce all of the things that we use on a daily basis. Now, biomanufacturing is very expensive, unlike other ways of doing manufacturing. The costs can be very high, and there are two examples here. The bottom example is from my laboratory that I talked about before. It took about $50 million for us to do the research and development to produce artemisinin using engineered yeast. In a similar vein, when DuPont tried to produce a precursor to carpet fiber, it cost them about $130 million for the research and development. We need to reduce those costs substantially if we want to use biology to produce all of the products we use. So why does it cost so much? Well, it costs so much because biological engineering is still very artisanal. We design at the desk. We then go into the laboratory and we pipette a lot of liquids around. We test it to see if the design we design works. And that takes a lot of time to do the testing. And then we try to learn from that. But usually we have a lot of failures along the way. And one cycle around this loop can take many months. It needs to take hours to days. So how do we reduce that? Well, companies have gotten pretty good at this, but they don't share their ideas with other people, with other companies, with academics. And so we don't learn as fast as we should. And people, students in my laboratory have many ideas, but they can't translate those into new companies because these companies often fail coming out of the gate because biological engineering is so difficult. But it doesn't have to be that way. How many of you have cell phones? Probably everyone in the audience has a cell phone. Those have silicon wafers in those. Those silicon wafers are manufactured in foundries. And the first foundries were developed in 1987. And in fact, most of the foundries are here in Asia. It used to be that when companies wanted to manufacture a computer, they would have their own foundry in-house, and they would build a design, and then they would go to the foundry and see if it worked. And when it didn't work, they'd come back, much like biology is right now. But then in 1987, that changed because we set standards for how to design and how to do manufacturing, and that allowed the development of merchant foundries. And this is just a list of the merchant foundries, and what you'll see is that almost all of them are here in Asia. Well, I think we can do the same thing for the biotechnology industry. The biotechnology industry continues to grow, but it could grow even faster. How do we make it grow faster? Well, this is how we think biology should be practiced, where we have a scientist working at a computer. They design the biology they want. They design a microbe, they design a new plant, they design an organism to produce a drug. They then send that design off to somewhere in the world, maybe Southeast Asia, where they build the biological system. Maybe it takes a few days to a few weeks to build it, and then they send the design, the organism that they've built, back to them. And they'll have an engineered organism that works and is ready to produce their product. This is what Apple and Samsung and all the other manufacturers of cell phones do. They send the chip off to be, the design off. They manufacture the chip at a distant location, at a foundry, and then they send it back to be incorporated into the cell phone. So this is what we're doing. We're building a foundry for biology. We're going to have automated design on the computer. We're going to have automated liquid handling to build the biological design, automated testing, and then machine learning using computer algorithms. And of course, all this is integrated together so that you achieve your target much faster. And in fact, we think that a centrally located foundry in a place like California or in Southeast Asia could serve many parts of the world, and even someday you'll have these foundries integrated and in various parts sharing, various parts of the world sharing their ideas and their designs so that we decrease the cost for engineering biology and can solve many of these problems. So this will bring the timelines down that we need to develop new products. This will allow more startups to be successful so that students can start companies and that they have a better chance of being successful, just like we now write apps and those turn into companies at a very low cost. So what will we do with this capability once it's fully developed? Well, one thing we'll do is develop new products. All of these things like carpet on the floor and paint on the wall are developed because we had leftovers from petroleum, leftovers from making fuel that somebody decided we should do something with in order to make that entire process more economical. Well, now we can do the same thing with biology, but biology is much more facile, can produce more interesting products. We might be able to have carpets that will repair themselves, tires that will repair themselves, paint that doesn't look old ever, that continues, maybe even changes color, and we could do this with biology. We can also look for new drugs for diseases. I mentioned to you that microbes have become resistant to many of the drugs that we now use, particularly antibiotics. And in fact, there are now multi-drug resistant organisms out there that are very hard to fight with the antibiotics we have. We want to go into the soil, pull out more antibiotics, and be able to test those faster and get them out to people when they need them to fight disease. And finally, we want to make it easier to produce food. One of the challenges in producing food in the world is that not everyone has access to fertilizers and to pesticides. And so people in Africa, for instance, becomes very hard to grow food, and they need it even more than in other parts of the world. If everyone had access to plants that would fix their own nitrogen, be self-fertilizing, and be resistant to pests, then everybody could produce food and we'd be able to feed the world. This is one of the projects that we intend to do. So this work that I talked about today was performed by people in my laboratory and by various other organizations. Amyris worked with us on the anti-malarial drug project, as did Sanofi, and that work was funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. The work on the biofuels was done at the Joint Bioenergy Institute, which is funded by the U.S. Department of Energy. I'd like to thank you for your time and attention.